Okay then guys, welcome to a Blimey It's Only. I'm delighted to have you. I think you were my first ever guest, Paul. I don't know when it was. Introduce him, Mr. Paul E. Moz, Paul Morrison. Good afternoon, Squire.
Hello there. I don't even want to think about how long ago it was now, because that means that it's that long since I said I was writing a book and still haven't finished it. I just want to apologise right now for ruining at least three Christmases for you.
I'm getting on in years, mate. You need to remember that.
You and me both.
It'll need to be on my gravestone, the man. I don't know. What could it be?
I'll just leave a copy there instead of flowers.
Just leave fling it in the coffin with me when I get burned, whatever.
You can read it in the afterlife.
If it makes you feel any better, my technical skills still haven't improved. I still had to fanny about for 20 minutes here to get this working. But
at least you actually have technical skills.
That's debatable. But anyway, listen, guys, we've got Paul on. I wanted to drag Paul on for a quick half an hour for a couple of reasons. Obviously, you've still got your book. How is the book going? Just tell people a bit about what it's called and what the aim is behind the book, Paul.
Well, the main book is called They Were Our Gods. And the idea is to sort of shine a spotlight on all those people. Well, not all, because there's hundreds of them. But basically, programmers, musicians, artists, even reviewers from back in the Commodore 64 Spectrum days. All those people who basically made our teenage years so much better by giving us all the great games that we had. So I've interviewed around 40 people for that. And the idea is to make a massive book out of it. And it is going to be massive. Because what I'm doing is I'm not just interviewing people and then putting the interviews in the book. I'm actually stripping out all the questions and writing a narrative between every answer. So it takes a long time. It's a bit more involved. I don't want to say it's more involved than most books or anything like that. But, you know, generally you see interviews with people and it is question, answer, question, answer. And I'm not going down that road. I'm asking the questions, I'm getting the answers, but I'm kind of telling the story as well. So I'm hoping it'll be something different anyway.
I mean, there are a glot of these things out there. Do you keep up to date with what's out there?
Oh yeah, I've got quite a lot of them. I kind of think, I don't want to sound immodest or anything, but I kind of think that in a way I set the ball rolling, because I started doing this back when From Bedrooms to Billions, the documentary was being filmed, and I'm still doing it. And since then, there's been like 20, 30 books all come out in the meantime. I feel like I kind of pioneered the idea in a way. So I'm hoping people won't be bored with it when it comes out. But there's going to be quite a lot of people in there that you've never read any interviews with before. Lots of original material, lots of great stuff. I mean, there's other people you see. You know yourself, there's some people from those days gone by that really embrace the whole retro scene. They do lots of interviews. You yourself, you interview Jim Bagley. I've got a big Jim Bagley interview in the book. So there will be things that you've seen elsewhere, but like I said, I've got some excellent exclusive content with people that you don't tend to see interviews with, and I'm not even going to say who they are right now.
Fantastic. How do you find, I mean, obviously, this what I'm doing just now, the Blimey, it's only, I try and speak to sort of people that have got involved in industry, or, you know, like yourself, you're just part of this whole kind of hobby of ours. How do you find, I mean, in my experiences, some people are very forthcoming. Other people, they'll read your message on Facebook and then they just simply don't reply.
Yeah, there's a bit of that. And it's. I mean, you understand it. I know when I've tried to get in touch with some people and they've written back and they don't want anything to do with that because it happened 30 years ago and their life's in a completely different place now and they're not interested in talking about it, which is fair enough, you know. It's not like if somebody says that, I'm not going to go harass them and say, oh, please, come on, just a few questions. I don't do that. If they don't want to talk about that anymore. It's a little bit more frustrating sometimes and yet still understandable when somebody says, yeah, great. And I spend ages writing a load of questions about everything and I send it off and then the questions don't get answered. So it's just a little bit frustrating mainly because you're looking forward to reading that stuff, you know. But I understand, because some of these Word documents I send out to people. See, I don't do it like this. If I did it on Skype, maybe I'd have a bit more luck with some people. But when you send a big Word document out, it's a hell of a lot to go through, and I can see where people would look at it and go, no, that's not really for me. But at the end of the day, I've got around 40 interviews. So, you know, if you can imagine how much room that's going to take up in a book.
Yeah. So how long in general on an average does it take you, say you're going to, well, you're interviewing somebody, How long would it take you from sort of cradle to grave to actually get that article finished by the time you've done the research and got the screenshots and that kind of stuff in?
I've sort of taken a different approach to it now, because what I did start doing was I'd get the interview back and I'd go through it, and then I just started, I got those ages ago, there was a thing where Adobe's InDesign, it was one of the really old versions, and they accidentally put it up for download for free. So I got that, and then they just left it like that so anybody can get it. So I learned how to use that to a degree. What the hell is that? I've got the thing up saying I'd have to stop recording or something, but never mind. We'll see what happens here.
Stop recording?
Yeah, some call recorder thing came up. I don't want to do that. I think it might be recording. I think I might be recording this as well.
Ah, right, okay.
Without even doing it.
My brother is watching, eh? Maybe it's Microsoft,
yeah. But anyway, I started using that program, and I did all right with it. I did some pages which I thought looked okay, but you know, when you see some of the other books that have come out lately, they were design-wise, they weren't anywhere near as good as that. So I made the decision right now, I'm just going to get all the words written, get that finished. Then I take screenshots as I go. I've got quite a few, but obviously I get more as well. And then I'll see about possibly getting somebody who's a bit more experienced in the design area to have a go at putting it into the sort of format that people would want to see, you know. So I have people who I talk to who I have in mind that could do that sort of thing. Otherwise, I could just try and do it myself, you know. One way or another, we'll get this thing done.
Yeah, I mean, I've got quite a lot of these books, and I find a lot of them tend to be just a screenshot that takes up the whole page and a wee bit about the game or whatever, and it's like, it's not really taking any time at all, and I find these books quite boring to read.
Yeah, you know, fair enough.
Like, there's nothing interesting, you know, I don't need to see a screenshot of Beachhead, I can bloody play it, or I can go and lay and look at it, you know, they just seem to be flung out.
They're a good nostalgia hit. You look through them and you see, and go, oh yeah, that was great, and they do have snippets from people who are involved and stuff, and they do serve a good purpose, and I've been involved with them to certain degrees, but I do think that mine's going to have a lot more reading involved, and you know what I'm generally doing. For instance, you get a programmer, just take for instance Jim Bagley as an example, so I've interviewed him about how he got started, and then he talks about every single game he wrote on the Spectrum. So every game he did is going to have a decent sized article about it, with stuff that happened when he was doing it or whatever. And the whole article without screenshots is over 20 A4 pages. So, you know, once I start putting screenshots in, you're looking at maybe 30 pages just on Jim Bagley, you know? So, so I think it's going to be something that people are going to really like getting stuck into. Mm-hmm. Hope so.
I'm sure it will. I'm certainly looking forward to it, as you know. I've been for the last 16 years, but anyway.
There's another thing about doing it, though. Sometimes you're writing that stuff and you can't help it. You get a bit of writer's block. And no matter how interesting the stuff is that you've got. So what I did, or what I've been doing, as a sort of spin-off to keep me writing while I've got writer's block, as I started writing a different book, which is probably not a very good idea.
Never made that book. Get one with the other one.
Well, this one, to be honest, the second book is about 75% finished already. It doesn't take long to do. I don't know if you ever heard of a book called Specky Nation.
Yeah, it's a very, yes, very short book. It's kind of written like a diary almost.
Kind of, sort of.
Yeah, I downloaded that from my Kindle, actually.
Yeah, it's a good book. It's good. So it just struck me that there was never any kind of Commodore 64 response to that. Because, you know, half the country, 48% of the country was Spectrum and 48% of the country was Commodore 64, and then the other 4% was BBC and Amstrad and whatnot.
That's been generous, I think.
It was more or less an even split, so I figured, well, those of us who were Commodore 64 fans, owners and what have you, we could do with something like that. So I was playing games and basically just writing a couple of pages. I picked 64 games that I thought were either iconic Commodore 64 games or maybe more obscure and under appreciated gems, and I've been writing about them, and I was quite close to getting that finished, and then I had a bit of a rethink, because I just had them all in alphabetical order. Basically, I was going to write an introduction, And I was going to just write, have each game in and then have a closing section. And I figured people would maybe rather have this in chronological order. So I started messing about and doing that. And so it's changed a little bit as to what I intended, and that drags it out. But yeah, it's something else that I'm working on. The idea kind of was to finish it quite quickly, see if I can get it out there. It's not going to be like massive in terms of production value or anything like that. And then if it sold any reasonable number of copies, use the money I got from that to sort of hire a cover artist for the main book, stuff like that, because I've got somebody in mind for that. You know, so it was just a little way of thinking. It served two purposes, and it's come along all right. So something else for you. You just think how big your Christmas stocking is going to be, because it's going to be so full of retro gems.
Just talking about writing, I mean, I think my dad was quite a bit of an author. He was a bit of a historian and that kind of thing. I think I've probably inherited his kind of like to get involved with stuff, hence the reason I do things like that. But one thing that's, I was like one of the first children to be born in Livingston, Newtown, where I live. Right. And I was just thinking about it, I thought there's never really been a sort of a definitive book about Livingston. And I was thinking about, I spoke to Andy Lowe and, you know, a couple of other guys that have written books, and, you know, he says, oh, great. He says, try and put down, like, is it 200 words a day, whatever it is. But I started doing it, and then I just found I've probably got so much other things that I can occupy my time that I just I've kind of not done it. But there's, I want to do it, but it feels too big. It feels, how can I put 49 years into a book?
Yeah. It is, it's really
what
hard.
What do you leave out, you know what I mean? What do you leave out?
I mean, especially when you haven't got that much free time. I mean, for me, I get up for work at 6 in the morning. I go out, there's quite a lot of travelling. Quite often I don't get back till 7 o'clock at night. I've got family, I've got kids, I've got things to do. So, you know, quite often I don't get to spend very much time at all doing this. And that's why it's taking so long, basically. But I do try and do something every day. I was talking to Andy Roberts, the Thalamus guy. He gave me a good idea. And I've got a spreadsheet now, which has got on all the articles I'm working on. So I've got it split up into every single article goes from 10 to 100%. I've got how many words I had originally and then how many words there are when it's finished. And I'm sort of filling it in every time I've complete what I feel as another 10% of the article. So I've got this big, colourful chart with I've got green lines on where the articles are finished and yellow and orange where they're close at the finish and red where I haven't written as much as I would like to. So it's a good way of keeping track of where I'm at and how the progress is going. And when I actually physically fill in cells on the spreadsheet every time I've done some writing, it just helps to sort of make me realise that it is actually being progressed. And I will finish the thing.
I asked that before, Paul. There obviously it has to come to an end. The thing is, what you're talking about is something that's almost infinite. I mean, do you ever get to a point and think, right, I'm going to get X number of people. Once that's done, that's it finished. And then you think, a minute, I could maybe speak to him. And it's just like, keep adding to it.
I'm at the point now where I'm not asking anybody else. I've got a couple of people who have said they are working on something and will send my answers back. But it's been a long time, so I don't know. We'll see if that happens. But I'm not asking for anybody else. If an amazing opportunity came up that I couldn't turn down, I would most definitely include anybody like that. But a couple of interviews that I've done that I'm not entirely sure if I'm going to include them or not, because they're not as complete as I would like them to be. So there's potential for replacements there, and then maybe I could do those other ones as some sort of bonus content or something. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes. As far as I'm concerned, I'm pretty much finished interviewing though.
Yeah. See, I mean, do you ever, like, you're maybe on social media or whatever, and then something pops up and you think, well, a minute, I'm going to try and get a hold of this guy. How does it work? Or did you make a list of people? These are the ones I'd really like to get a hold of. And how did it grow? Is it one of these things that's just kind of...
I've got a folder on my computer. And in that folder, there's about 250 subfolders, all which are named after people I would like to have got in touch with. And when I did get in touch with them and they agreed, then I obviously put things into those folders. And now I've got around 40 where they're actually completed. And the rest of them are still sitting there. Could potentially still get in touch with those people for They Were Our Gods Volume 2. If I can get hold of them, and then I would certainly do that, because there's a lot of interesting people who have never really been interviewed or talked with about this sort of thing. So yeah, it is, like you say, almost infinite, but 40 sounds like a good number, doesn't it?
It certainly does, aye. What's I think quite interesting, like with what I do on YouTube, every now and again somebody will comment in a video and you're like, what the hell, it's that guy. I don't know if I mentioned this before, there was a back in the day my mate had a Spectrum, I had a Commodore 64, and we decided we'd swap for the night, so I had his Spectrum, he had my Commodore, and
you got it back.
Well, aye. Like, you see, he wasn't really a fan of the Commodore and vice versa, but I went through, loaded up Night Lore, and too difficult, and I was never really a fan of the Spectrum. I always, you know, that's changed now. I mean, I've got multiple Spectrums, and the Spectrum's a fantastic machine, it really is. You've just got to, I always thought that when you look at Drop Zone and you look at, like, or Bruce Lee, and then you look at Spectrum Bruce Lee, it just looks shite. It's like white and black graphics, it's like rubbish. It's like the pound stretchers of games. However, I now realise that Spectrum is a fantastic machine.
But
I was never a fan. I never, you know, I would go up to his house and say, he was like, oh, do you want a shot? Nah. I would be quite happy just watching him playing it.
Yeah.
Never really saw it. But the one game, I went through C90, loading up the different games, and then I loaded up this one called Formula One by CRL. And it was basically, the best way to describe it is Football Manager with racing cars. You know, you pick your team, you can name your driver, etc. And then you just all you can see is the finishing post, is that what you call it? Whatever it is, you get the line, and you just see the cars, and then it updates, you know, Alan's up to second place. And it's just literally just, you get this little sort of, you know, highlights.
2 minutes.
Aye, and I actually sat up all night, played it. That's just fantastic, brilliant. And so I made a video of that maybe last year. And then a guy commented and saying, thanks very much for your kind comments. It was me and that actually wrote it. I'm like, what the hell, you know? And I got in touch with the guy, and I think the guy's in his 70s now. And he told me that the guy that he'd rented sadly passed away, you know. But it's bizarre how, obviously, he must have sat on YouTube one day thinking, I'll just see if there's any videos with this game. And then I had one just a couple of weeks ago. I made a video, the evolution of the Commodore 64 loader. Table.
Oh, right.
Basically, I was just thinking, as I was loading up a tape, I thought, there's been so many different itinerations of loaders and music, so, you know. And it's actually proved to be really popular. I mean, Martin Galway actually commented on it. And I instantly fired off a PM to him saying, do you want to get an interview? But he never got back to me. But the other guy, the guy that just commented last week, was the guy that said that I actually wrote, is it Fast Load, which was first used on Daley Thompson's Decathlon in the Commodore 64. It's bizarre, like, you know.
I'll have a look at that one, because I do look at your videos, but you put that many up that I miss some of them, so...
Best thing to do, the best tip I can give you is, if there's a particular type of video that you like, I mean, I've got my
playlists.
You've got all my different playlists. So if you like your, my favourite one is probably the, apart from talking to yourself, is probably the They Did What, where I just look at a software company and all the different things. But that's the easiest way to do it. But yeah, it can be a bit overawed when you see.
I like the Arcade Perfect ones as well. They're good.
They seem to be. They're quite easy to do, and they seem to go down pretty well. Like, but yeah, they're not.
It's always warned me never to play Green Beret on the C16 anyway.
Bloody hell, how that got past you, I don't know. But hey, listen, Paul, we want to try and keep this to half an hour. The second part of what we want to speak to you, obviously, is you've got a charity thing coming up. I'll let you tell, you know, talk about it. It's coming up at the end of March, is it? I think you're...
Yeah, it is, yeah. It's something I've thought about doing for ages, and I didn't really know how to go about it. I think with the advent of things like Twitch and so on, and streaming and everything being popular, I just thought, maybe I'll do something like that. So anyway, the charity I'm doing for is Young Epilepsy. My youngest brother was, I think, 16 when he, I don't know if you develop epilepsy, how it happens, but when he had his first seizure anyway, the horrible things to see, that's a really bad one. And it's an awful thing, you know. I don't know if you ever knew anybody, but... you quite often used to have somebody in a class, maybe you would have epilepsy, and if they had a seizure in class or something, it's a really horrible thing for young people.
they don't understand it. Yeah, it's quite frightening.
Well, exactly. It's, I think people are confused, they're frightened, they don't know what to do. And I just think for young people living with that as well, it's a horrible thing. So this charity, Young Epilepsy, does a lot of work sort of helping young people to have better lives and understand what it is, I suppose. So yeah, my brother actually died of a seizure when he was 26. So it's one of those things, because it can be completely avoidable. It could have been avoided in his case, but I guess the lack of knowledge and information about it is probably something that leads to people having more problems than they might otherwise have. So anyway, kind of in tribute to him in a way, but also just to sort of raise awareness a little bit, I thought I would do something, and seeing as games are the things that I love, it makes sense to do something along those lines. People might think it's a bit strange because you've heard of photosensitive epilepsy, where if you play a video game, it can trigger. So, you know, it's like, what's he doing that for? Well, that's only like in a very small number of cases. And my brother, Jamie, actually loved video games anyway. He played a lot all the way. I mean, he was, what, nearly 10 years younger than me. But we still used to play things, even like Rock and Wrestle would play together. Right the way up, he particularly enjoyed my Sega Saturn. I'd go to work on a day, and I come home and find he'd obliterated all my Sega Rally times on stuff. So, you know, he was a big fan of games. I thought, this is something I like. It's something I'm going to do. So what I'm going to do is, it's March 26th, which is World Epilepsy Day. It's also Mother's Day, inconveniently.
It's March 26th. Is that a Sunday?
Sunday, yeah.
Ah, bugger. Sorry, no, I'm just being selfish. I'm actually going to be away in Arran. When are you actually starting it? What time are you starting?
Well, like I say, it's Mother's Day. I'm going to have to pop up and see my mother, so I'll do that early in the day. I'm probably going to do it from about 12 noon, and I'm going to do it for, I reckon, 12 hours. So,
I'll be able to tune in for the last 6 hours or so, yeah.
Yeah, there'll be plenty of scope for people to join and have a look.
Again, excuse my ignorance, Twitch, That's what I call a Twitch. I've heard of it. I don't. I was going to say, yeah. What is Twitch? So is it a live streaming? You can stream video, whatever.
There's a lot of things like that now. You can do it on YouTube as well, but Twitch is quite popular. And yeah, basically you set it up, and it'll take the feed from whatever the program is you're using to play the game on. And you can also put your camera on as well. I'm not going to guarantee that I'm going to have the camera stay at my face for 12 hours.
You see the point of that.
I'll have it on, and I'll be talking as I'm playing the games. But I might have it pointing up the ceiling or something. You know, I'm not necessarily going to have it looking at my face for the whole 12 hours. But the idea is, I'm just going to play mostly Commodore 64 and Spectrum games. But Twitch, it has a live stream, it has a live feed, it also has a chat room, so people can go in there and type all sorts of stuff down the side. So I'll keep an eye on that, I'll be able to read that. People are free to make comments if they'd like to see me play anything in particular, because it's going to be quite a fluid list. I mean, I've picked out something like 150 games so far, and well, that should last 12 hours, you would imagine. But who?
Here's a little suggestion. What would be excellent? Presumably you're going to have a sort of link to, like, is it a Just Giving page or something, or whatever it is.
I have got a link to a Just Giving page. Yeah. When you put this up, I'll probably put a reply on with the link to that and the link to the.
And what I'll do? I mean, we'll put obviously the link to it. And if it's all right, once you've this Twitch thing, will that be? See, once it's finished. Can somebody go in and watch it later on?
I think so. I'm not quite sure how it works yet. I've only done one test stream, but there is some sort of facility either through Twitch or I think on the program that you actually use to stream off your computer. I think that can record the feed as well. So one way or another, I think I'll be able to save it, so it'll be able to be watched after the event.
Because what I'll do is, I can, if you give me the link to the video, I'll make a video just featuring it, so, you know, at the end of the day, to get somebody to stick a couple of quid in, then it's all good.
Yeah, great, yeah, definitely.
Another interesting thing would be, I know you're quite a good games player, is, right, if you can get, I don't know, 300,000 in Drop Zone, I'll stick a fiver in, or,
you know,
and if you don't, you've got to put a tenner in.
Never managed that, but I'm decent at some games. I'll play some that hopefully I'll be able to play through to the end. I know there's a game that I'm going to play that a lot of Commodore 64 fans had a really hard time with. It's a Mastertronic game called The Human Race.
Good music. That's
it's got tremendous music. It's got five great Rob Hubbard tunes. I played that to death when I was younger because obviously because I wanted to hear the tune. Once I got past the first level and found there was a different tune on the second level, I was like, oh, well, what's coming next? So I played that game so many times. And you go on websites like Lemon and stuff, and like 90% of people, this is the hardest game ever. I couldn't get past the first screen. And I'm like, I completed it hundreds of times. So I'll play that one and I'll complete it. And I'll play... I mean, there's others that I've completed that are really hard. I'm not saying I can do it again. I've completed Monty on the Run before, but I'm not saying I can complete it this time. The last V8, that was absolutely rock hard. I'll probably give that a shot at some point. I'm not just playing Commodore 64 games. These are just examples from when I was younger. I'll see if I can. I'll have every intention of trying to complete at least a couple of them. I'm thinking of working out some kind of a timetable, so at least for some games in particular, you'll know exactly when I'm going to play them. So if it's
a good idea,
then you say, "Oh, look, at 3 o'clock he's going to play a Paradroid," then people go, "Come on, 3 o'clock and watch, and I'll play that." And at 6 o'clock he's going to play a Jetpack or whatever. Like, I might do something like that. I might do a themed hour where I play 1 hour just of the Commodore 64, or 1 hour just of the Spectrum, or 1 hour just of Houston Consultants games, possibly. That's an option. People can feel free to comment on any ideas they might have, by all means. Certainly open to suggestions, because this is new to me as well, but I think it's good.
How are you going to make people aware of this? Are you just going to put it on your Facebook page? Or
I'm doing that. I'm every day on Facebook and Twitter, because I've everything I've got to the AWOW Gods, if you want to have a look, just type that in on the Twitter and the Facebook. I've got my website as well. But on Twitter and Facebook, anyway, every day I'm posting a picture of a game that I'm going to be playing on that day. And then I'm putting the link to the Just Given page on there. So I'm trying not to be too spammy about it. I want people to know that this is happening. But on the other hand, if I'm posting 30 messages a day on everything I've got, people just get sick of it and not be interested. You know? And, there's nothing worse than reading that over and over again. But sure, yeah, if anybody's interested.
We'll put a link down below, guys, if you want to follow Paul with that and support him, then the link will be below.
Yeah, brilliant.
The more the merrier. So, excellent stuff. The Switch, I know you've not got one. You're not a fan of Nintendo.
I don't know what it is. I've never really owned many Nintendo consoles, and I've never really played that many of the games, and I don't know why. I'm sure that they're tremendous. I mean, even when I had, say, the GameCube, all the games that I preferred were not Nintendo games. I mean, stuff like Killer 7 or something was my favourite game on that. I'm always a bit more for off-the-wall games, and then don't even start with Mario Sports games. Like, I can't stand them. I don't know what it is. I mean, I'm sure that Zelda game's tremendous, but I don't know. I've got too many other things going.
When I was making a cup of tea, I was thinking about Nintendo and why you don't like them. I think possibly Nintendo. You're very much hardcore arcade. You're born and bred in an arcade. There's not many sort of Twitch shooter games on these machines. Yeah. Generally, things like Zelda or whatever it is, the more kind of family orientated games. I don't think Nintendo. I think that's where maybe Nintendo miss out. They miss out on the sort of the hardcore, hard edge PC gamers that like.
It's probably a fair point. I mean, I'm not really a first-person shooter type of person or anything like that. I kind of like quirky games, I suppose. I like things that are a bit different. And I don't mean I know Nintendo's very innovative with all the things they do, but, you know, at the end of the day, it's still Mario running along, jumping on creatures' heads and collecting coins, isn't it, at the end? So, you know, I just like things a bit more off the wall than that. But
I stumbled on a game. What day was it? It was one night last week. Project X, and it's not the Amiga game, you heard it. It's a new game that's come out on the PC. I've actually got a video made, but I've still got to put the commentary, which I'll probably do after this. But it's a guy that's written, it's completely free, it's a shoot 'em up, and everybody's sprite is just Spectrum graphics.
Oh, yeah, I did see something about that the other day.
It's absolutely mental. I mean, the amount of time, the presentation of what the guy's done is phenomenal. You've got, Crash magazines, and it's incredible. It's quite, you know, it's really, really well done. Really well done.
I saw a picture of it or something, and I made a note to have a look later and then forgot about it, so I'm glad you reminded me.
You can watch my video, it'll be up shortly.
Yeah, we'll do. Once I get back from playing snooker later on, I'll have a look.
What was I going to say? You didn't happen to, well, you, I think you mentioned it to me, the Frogger game that came out for the C64.
Oh, man.
I don't know if you watched the video I put out. I recorded myself. Yeah, I recorded. Did you watch it?
Together, wasn't it? Yeah.
I mean, that was completely unrehearsed. I recorded myself playing the Commodore game, one game of that, then I played one game of the arcade, and then I spliced them together, and it was incredible. I couldn't believe what I was seeing, just how the timing was almost spot on.
It was amazing, wasn't it? I never cease to be amazed at what people are doing with those 8-bit computers these days. I do pay more attention to the Commodore 64 side of things because I write for Commodore 64 magazine called Reset. So we cover a lot of that stuff. But things like that, there's the Donkey Kong one. So there's, obviously, you know, the Commando and the Ghosts and Goblins. There's a new version of Bomb Jack coming out soon.
That looks pretty good.
It's just, I mean, and people say, why are they doing that? You can play them on MAME. But I just think it's a fantastic thing that people are doing, just to show what these machines are still capable of, what they could have been capable of back then if they'd only known it. Can you imagine if we got those arcade conversions back in 1985? Would it be
absolutely cool? Arcade, it's just astonishing. It really is. Yeah, I mean, there's a bit of me thinking sometimes, why would I want to play, you know, Ghosts and Goblins in the Commodore 64 when I can play the arcade one?
Yeah,
you'd have to have been there at the time to appreciate.
To be fair, it's a different game though, isn't it? It's a different game. It's a conversation, but it still doesn't necessarily play the same. It's a different interpretation of it, and it definitely, they have their own merits. And if you liked that computer at the time, what's wrong with having more stuff for it? Be it arcade conversions or the new games. I mean, there's so many new games coming out, and the presentation of them, the technical achievements, you just think, that's amazing that people are finding all this stuff to do. Did you play all those games in that that was in the Reset magazine, the 4K craptastic games competition? And there was tons of entries, and some of them for 4K. I mean, okay, it's compressed, but you can't believe the things that people can do nowadays. It's like this whole 8-bit computer scene is just taking off in a whole new direction. It's brilliant.
Mm-hmm. I mean, some of the games that they're putting out for the Vectrex now are just insane.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got, I was lucky enough to get the Vector Pilot, which is basically Space Pilot.
Oh, yeah.
It is probably the best version of Space Pilot I've ever played. It's just
brilliant.
Incredible, absolutely incredible.
Yeah, you got to have a Vectrex first, you lucky man. You've got to have a Vectrex first, you lucky man.
I've got two, I've got a spare one in the loft.
Who has a spare Vectrex lying around? Obviously.
Aye, I must admit, I mean, I never make any secret of the fact that the Vectrex is, you know, if I had to rescue one system, it would be the Vectrex. It's just, you can't replace it, you can't emulate it. Saying that, I've got to say, the iPad app that came out a few years ago is pretty good, but it's not the same. You don't have that hum that you get when you switch to the...
Yeah, it's a pretty special machine, the Vectrex. Maybe one day I'll come and steal yours out of the loft.
Oh, you're welcome to come up. I've got a wee games museum that nobody else bar me wants to actually use. I've got these systems. I'd like somebody like yourself who's got the same passion and enthusiasm to actually want to come up and use them.
Absolutely.
Excellent. So then, listen, Paul, we're getting to that time now. I know you've got stuff to do. I've got stuff to do. Thank you very much for... I know we talk to each other every day anyway, but, you know, taking time to come on the channel again. And I says anyone obviously that's watching this, the link will be down below for Paul's charity event on the 26th of March, which is a Sunday, and it's going to kick off about midday, you reckon, eh?
Yeah, I think so.
We'll put up the actual video of it as well, and any donations would be really appreciated. So anyway, that just remains to say thank you very much, Paul. Have a lovely day, and thanks for catching up, mate.
Yeah, thanks very much for having me on and for publicising this little event I'm going to do. Much appreciated, and anybody's welcome to come and watch and donate. Thanks a lot.
Stuff. Take care, man. Bye.
Cheers now as well. Bye-bye.